What's up? I'm Adam.
And I'm Simon.
In this video, I'm super excited. Simon is joining us to help us understand where do we start when we bring in files to our lakehouse. And also it could be your data warehouse, but we're focusing on the lakehouse because of Spark. And there's no better person I can think of to talk about Spark than Simon Whiteley. Simon, just quickly introduce yourself. Tell people who you are and profess your love of Spark.
Okay. My name's Simon Whiteley. Hello. I run a company called Advancing Analytics and a YouTube channel called, Advancing Analytics. And I talk about Spark a lot.
Yes.
So if you want to know how Spark works, what Delta is, how the deep and dirty performance tuning things works, if you want to be a real Spark nerd, that's what I do.
Simon, I need help. I got some files into OneLake in the lakehouse. I see them. But what do I do? Where do I go?
It's really tricky because you might be looking at Fabric. I might be looking at this experience and going, why is he talking about Spark? There's a lakehouse and there's notebooks and nowhere does it actually mention Spark anywhere.
All right, so Simon, hold up. I know you may be new to the whole guy in a cube thing, but enough of all this talking. Let's do what? Let's head over to your machine.
All right, this is my lakehouse and it's a very basic lakehouse. Basically, someone's got hold of OneLake, they've dropped some files in. So I've got a little folder and I've got a couple of files. I've got a CSV and I've got a JSON file. And I want to look at it. I want to do something with it. I want to be able to play with that data. Maybe I want to turn it into a table so I can then make it into a Power BI model. And that's where we're starting, right? So we need to make a new notebook. We need to start having a play. I've clicked the new notebook button. I said, make me a new notebook. And this is what I've got. I've got a notebook with not much going on.
So this is all I need, right? We're good.
Done. Pretty much. Well, we're not done, but we're ready to start.
Got it.
We've got PySpark over here. We know this is a PySpark notebook, so it's going to want us to write Python in. And I can make sure things are working by just going, actually, no, I can't say hello around here, can I? And that's going to start my Spark session. That's going to mean that I know things are working. And that's going to take a little bit of time to actually start up, and then I can start having a play with it. And then you can see automatically, I've got my lakehouse over here. You can see it's sine a cube.
Yes, I appreciate that.
I know. That I'm hilarious.
Nice. That is nice.
And we can see the files that I've got down here already. So it's plugged in, it's ready to go. So easiest thing I can possibly do is just click here and go, you know what? Load my data and load it as Spark. I've got two choices here. I can use Spark or Pandas. Pandas is like native Python and it's something used by a load of data scientists. And it's kind of like, you use it if you're using Python on your local machine on a single machine.
Okay.
If you're trying to do something that takes a lot of data and spreads out and a big scalable processing thing, that's gonna be Spark. So I click that button and that makes me a new cell. And I've got a lot of stuff. Once my session started, I can run that, and that will actually go read that CSV for me and just show me what that data looks like. So if we go and run this, we can see, so it's going off, it's having a look at it, it's reading that CSV, it's bringing it back, and there we go. It's easy as that. As a Spark person, there's just a couple of things I would immediately do just to tidy this up. And this is me being a boring code pedant. I just need to quickly fix this just to make it nicer.
Just to bring some warmth into your heart and not, cry.
First things first, Python can only be read on one line. You have to have one big long line of code, which is really hard to read. This is like, it's too long, right? We need to see all of that stuff.
And I think that's just no fine, good. But...
No. So we can fix it. And the way we fix it is we simply wrap it in brackets. What that means is it ignores some of the formatting inside there. Mm-hmm. And then we can just go, well, actually, I can break this up, make this a little bit easier to read, a little bit easier to work with. That's just the way we tend to write Spark these days. And that's a bit easier to see what's going on. The other thing's this giant thing. When we had our files up here, we could see in this thing, we can go and get the full ABFS path. That's the full direct path to the lake. Yep. But that's too long. What we need is the relative path, and that just ignores all of this context. All the way to over here where it's talking about files. We don't need any of that. That does exactly the same thing. The Fabric notebook knows where it's running. It knows it's got that file there.
Yep.
It doesn't need the full thing each time. If you wanted to take that same code and run it somewhere else and have it always point to that same file, you need that full path, but here we don't. Easy, right? We've got a table of data. We can see what's there. And that's where most people get to and go, how do I work with this? How do I write SQL on it? How do I explore it? How do I use that data now?
Do something with it, right? I can see the data now, but now I want to do something with it. Or ultimately, maybe your goal is you want to get it into a Power BI report, right? So down the lines, but we got to do some things before we get there.
Two things we can do. One, well, actually, there's many things we can do in Spark. There's a million things. I could write a load of PySpark and do a lot of transformation and select certain columns and aggregate stuff and all that good stuff you can do. You can write PySpark to do it. But when you're just first starting, that seems hard. It'll learn a whole new language. One of the things you can do in Spark, you can mix and match between SQL and Python really easily. So What we're going to do is we're going to write a SQL query on this data and just query it as if it was a table.
All right.
And then we're going to take that query and say, well, actually just write the results of that query down as a table, and then we can use that. That's the plan.
Ooh, I like that.
The first thing is, because we're switching from Python to SQL, SQL's not aware of this thing called DF. It doesn't know what that data frame is. We need to say, actually, just make this thing visible to SQL. I need to write some new code. And you say my data frame. And then I've got this thing called create a replace temp view. And it's a little bit like making a temp table in SQL, except it's not copying the data. It's just a little temporary pointer saying that the CSV's over there.
And there's no tempdb database or anything like that.
No. So data frame, create a replace temp view, and it's Python. This is all case sensitive. It won't know what you're talking about unless it's lowercase, then uppercase, all the way through camel case. Yep.
Camel case for the win.
And if I run that, that's just telling SQL, actually pretend there's a table called vehicle data and we can go and select from it.
Okay.
So I can do another command, percentage SQL. In a Fabric notebook, that's basically just saying, I want to switch languages. My default language is PySpark. I'm saying, actually, for this one cell, ignore that and just treat this as SQL.
And this is going to be Spark SQL, not T-SQL. So be aware of that.
This is not T-SQL. I'm going to select start from my vehicle data. And you can just write SQL, go and explore the data. You can write case statements, you do window functions, you can do aggregates, all the stuff you can do. Now, what I'm going to do is trim down that select a little bit, because there's some dodgy columns in there. There's a bit of weird stuff. So I'm just saying, I only want a couple of those columns, and I've got that as a select statement, just to tidy up some of the columns I'm working with.
And that's just general good practice, right? Only bring in what you need. So if you're never going to use that stuff, don't bring it in.
People debate about that in a lake, because in the early stages, you might bring everything in just so you don't have to go back to the source.
Yeah.
But then when you're shaping something for people to analyze, absolutely, only give them what they need.
So it goes back to that the whole medallion layer concept of bronze, silver, gold.
About which I have opinions.
I'm sure you do. Maybe we can do another video on that. Put in the comments below if you want to hear Simon's opinions on that.
So the tricky thing, I've written a SQL statement and I've got my results back, but I want to get that back into the Python side of things. And that feels weird because I've got this cell, but it doesn't go anywhere. It's not in a variable or anything. So I've got a new cell. So I'm going to say, well, I want this new data frame is equal to spark.sql. And then that's just going on a string. So I can just copy and paste that same SQL statement. You can see it's highlighting it and it's treating it like it was SQL in there.
Nice.
And that's just going to give me a new data frame of whatever result my SQL gave it. So I can run that. And that brings me back a new data frame. And again, I had that kind of command I used earlier of just display. Show me what's inside that new data frame. I can go and check and say, has that listened to me? Yeah. There we go. County, city, vehicle ID. And everyone always assumes that's going to be slow, right? Because I'm jumping from Python to SQL to Python to SQL. And you kind of get this thing in your head about you're moving data.
But it's all Spark. It's just how the engine's translating what you're doing, right?
If I wrote that out as PySpark, if I write it out as SQL, it runs the same thing under the hood. It does not matter which language you use. Yep. Minor caveats, unless you do something really weird. If I'm writing something that should be automated, like do this thing in a loop and do it many times, that's Python. Yeah, Python's a programming language.
Sure.
If I'm doing transformation and turning something into a factor dimension, if I'm building something for analytics, I write that in SQL. It is a healthy mix of Python and SQL that we work with. So finally, I want to take my new data frame. I want to turn that into a table that I can actually access. So I'm going to get here. So I'm going to take my new data frame and say I want to write it out. I'm going to tell it I want to write it as Delta. So we're storing it as that format that's used across all of Fabric. I've got a tattoo across my back just saying Delta.
All right.
I don't, but you know, one day. And then finally, I'm going to save as table. So I want it to appear in my list of tables. I want it to be managed by Fabric. I want it to be part of my full Lakehouse thing. So I'm just saying save as table. And then I'm going to call this my vehicle table just to make sure it's different.
One thing to note, and through the magic of editing, we went back. Don't have spaces in your column name. At the time of this recording, that is a limitation right now with inside of Fabric specifically. So just be aware of that. But now, Simon, this should show up in the table list.
Yeah. I'm going to go over here. Going to hit refresh.
Bam.
So I've now got my vehicle table.
There it is.
And then I can go and load that data into Spark and query it from Spark and into like a whole new thing.
Or you could be adventurous and go back into the Lakehouse and create your data set or semantic model and then start using it with Power BI. We know the ultimate end goal is we get them into a Power BI report so we can then export it to Excel.
And then the circle of life is complete.
It is.
And then we save it to CSV and we load it to a Lakehouse and we just...
So Simon, this is, it's fairly straightforward. You can get started quickly through the notebook without writing any Python and then format it a little bit, which is not hard. You know, we're just adding a few things in there and then go to SQL at that point and then you can write it back. I love it. That's not... That doesn't scare me. So if you want to go this notebook direction, give it a try. You might be surprised. All right, Simon, thank you so much for being with us and showing us how to get started with Python and demystifying some of this to make it not so scary. Folks, if you want to learn more about this topic, go over to Advancing Analytics. Links are in the description below. Go check out, he's got courses and they've got videos on their YouTube channel to help you out as well. And let us know in the comments below if there's another topic you want to learn about or something maybe we're missing or you want to explore. As always, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome and we'll see you in the next video.